Hi, and welcome to the conference. My name is Rick Queen from the Division of Surface Water. I manage the 401 Isolated Wetlands Permitting Program, and we're going to talk about how our permitting process works, some of the key points that you need to know in acquiring a permit, and also hopefully take questions on anything that you'd like to ask regarding some of your past permitting experiences. Kind of a quick overview here. We want to talk about why the 401 and isolated wetland permitting is important to the state of Ohio, and a brief overview of the rules and laws, our assessment methods for different waters, the permitting process for 401 and isolated wetlands, which are somewhat different, and kind of what's new and what's next, what's upcoming for the program. Why this is important. The Federal Clean Water Act set forth several objectives. The biggest objective that applies to the state of Ohio when it comes to 401 and isolated wetland permitting is the biological integrity of nation's waters. Now, that biology is important because it is an indicator of the quality of the water, and we're required to, like it says here, to restore and maintain that quality. So we need to bring poor quality streams into compliance or bring them up environmentally, and we need to maintain high quality waters in their current conditions. We talk about reference reaches a lot within the state of Ohio. We're looking at a best attainable condition, essentially a segment of the stream, or when it comes to a wetland, a certain wetland that is about the best attainable condition that we can get for that type of stream in that region. Reference condition does not reflect pre-European settlement, so it's the best that we have now currently on the landscape. Ohio EPA has identified several reference reaches and several reference wetlands in the state of Ohio, which we can talk about later. This is kind of a busy slide, but and I'm not going to try to explain it all, but it kind of gives you an idea of all the different criteria and factors that are involved in determining chemical variables, flow regime, biotic factors, energy source, habitat structure, etc. And that all of these features and criteria are all put together to determine whether a water is reaching the principal goal of the Clean Water Act. The five most important causes of stream impairment in the state, and I'm sure you've heard this many times, organic enrichment, i.e. sediment running into streams, hydromodification, again, that's kind of habitat destruction or alteration, hydrology, that's hydrologic modification. Habitat modification is the actual structure of the stream or structure of the wetland. Nutrients that's entering the site, again, a sediment-laden situation. And then siltation from sediment is the fifth. You can kind of tell there by looking at it that in watersheds, if you look at a watershed approach, that's the blue bar. If you look at a large river approach, you can kind of see the impairment caused by watershed and by large river, sort of a comparison bar chart. Common wetland functions. When we're talking about wetlands now, we're talking about, I'm sure you've all heard of things like wetlands are the sponges of nature, and they're also the kidneys of nature, and these seven criteria here kind of point that out. We've got wildlife nursery and habitat as an important function of a wetland. Floodwater retention is extremely important. Pollutant filtering, treatment, and uptake is very important as well. Groundwater recharge, so people's drinking wells and water well fields are all impacted by either positively or negatively by groundwater recharge from wetlands. Of course, there's a lot of recreation and hunting activities that take place on wetlands. Educational purposes, a lot of schools now around the state and a lot of nature preserves, etc., have education features in their wetland areas, so they're very positive and very profitable, I guess, to some of those organizations as far as getting people out to look at those sites and learn about nature. And then, of course, detention, sediment control is another important wetland function. Another thing you've probably heard many times, wetland loss in Ohio. It's assumed or it's sort of been guesstimated that around 90% of the wetlands in the state of Ohio since the 1700s, since people were inhabiting Ohio, white settlers were inhabiting Ohio, about 90% of those wetlands have been lost. Primarily, most of those are in the Black Swamp area in northwestern Ohio. And out of that 5 million approximate acres that were here at one time, about 482,000 acres remain today. This is just kind of a depiction of the Black Swamp up in northwestern Ohio. It was one of the largest wetland areas in the country at one time, and it also now probably has the largest extent of field tile of any place in the country. Federal and state statutes and regulations. Of course, federal law, that's the Clean Water Act, and there's Section 404 and 401 of that Clean Water Act. We here in Ohio, we administer the Section 401 of the Clean Water Act. That's the 401 water quality certifications. Also, with that, we have Ohio Revised Code 6111, and that takes care of both wetlands regulated under the Clean Water Act and isolated wetlands, which are only regulated by Ohio and a few other states. So Clean Water Section 404, that's administered by the Army Corps of Engineers, and the Corps then does a lot of the important work, such as jurisdictional determinations. They conduct a public interest review that is in some ways more expensive than the state of Ohio, in that they have to coordinate on historic properties, recreation, food, fiber, shoreline erosion, as well as streams, wetlands, etc. Clean Water Act Section 401, of course, like I said, that's the state water quality certification part of the Clean Water Act, and that is in Ohio, administered by Ohio EPA, Division of Surface Water. And what we do here in the Division of Surface Water is certify that a proposed action does not interfere with state water quality standards. Some of the regulated activities that you may need a permit for, both for 401 and 404 permits, would be dredge and fill material, placing dredge and fill material into waters of the U.S. below the ordinary high water mark. And that can be for a variety of activities. There are several different permits that are involved with those, and we'll talk about those later. But when we talk about the ordinary high water mark, this drawing kind of illustrates the high water mark. It's not the normal water mark of a stream. As you can see, the dark cross-hatched bottom of that depression, that would be the normal water level. And then the dotted line is the ordinary high water mark, and that's usually determined by where erosional features on the side of a stream bank stops, and from that point on you're getting vegetative growth. So that line between those two is an ordinary high water mark depiction, and that is determined by the Corps of Engineers. This is kind of another sort of busy picture here, but it sort of indicates if you see the wetland boundary, which is right in the middle of the site and some to the upper right-hand corner, if you can see the dotted line area, the dark dotted line area is the actual wetland, but then if you see on occasion there are some areas that are light but still have the dotted area, that would be the ordinary high water mark of that wetland. So that's an area that's normally doesn't hold water but occasionally does hold water in high water events. And that applies to both wetlands and streams, that ordinary high water mark. Now, isolated wetlands are no longer regulated by the Corps of Engineers, are no longer considered federal waters. There was a decision back in 2001, the Swank decision, that determined that wetlands that are isolated from navigable waters are no longer regulated by the feds and cannot be considered jurisdictional based solely on the presence of migratory birds, which is another aspect of how the Corps used to look at whether a particular water was regulatory or was jurisdictional from a federal standpoint. isolated wetlands, though, are regulated under state law. Some other significant legal cases. In January of 2001, the Supreme Court, like I just mentioned, talked about the Swank case, made a decision that removed isolated wetlands from jurisdiction, and then in 2001, Governor Taft signs into law House Bill 231, and that particular law granted the authority to Ohio EPA to regulate those now non-jurisdictional waters of the state. The Reconis decision was another important decision that came about in 2006. That was another Supreme Court ruling, and that was in response to a legal challenge, and it essentially determined that there was a new procedure for determining jurisdictional status of streams and wetlands. So these two decisions combined, the Swank decision and the Reconis decision, both resulted in the Corps of Engineers losing some significant jurisdictional abilities, and we here at the state of Ohio had to fill that gap with our current wetland law. Okay, we'll talk about federal permits now for a moment. We've got general permits, which there are really three kinds of general permits that are administered by the Corps of Engineers. One's a nationwide permit, and those are activity-based. So there are 50-some right now. They used to have around 30, so they're fleshing out more and more specific activities and covering those under separate nationwide permits now. There's also a letter of permission, which is another general permit that is usually more regional in nature, but not really a regional permit. So in other words, it could be a combination of a couple of nationwide permits that only apply to, let's say, a portion of the state of Ohio. And then we have regional permits, which generally, again, are even more specific, and they're in a very specific region, and they're a very specific activity. But again, they can be a combined a combination of both nationwide permits and even a letter of permission for that matter. All those are general permits that the federal government administers, and then of course there's individual permits that require more rigorous analysis, and that's of course the Section 404 permit from the Corps of Engineers and the Section 401 water quality certification from the Ohio EPA. And it's kind of important to point out here that a Section 401 is issued for a 404. It's somewhat issued for the actual activity, but it's really permitting the Corps of Engineers to or giving 401 water quality certification to a Corps of Engineers 404 permit. Ohio EPA 401 water quality certification for nationwide permits. We currently have our most recent certification on our website. If you'd like to see that. But the key points to this to remember is that for most impacts, we're looking at under a half an acre of Cat 2 or Cat 1 wetlands, and there are no impacts allowed to Category 3 wetlands. That's, as a general rule, that's the case. There are a few exceptions, but generally speaking, that's the case. Streams, we're looking at less than 300, so 300 or less linear feet of total impact to streams, and again, there are no impacts to the higher quality waters in the state, such as EWH, cold water habitat, seasonal salmonid, et cetera, and even some of the national and state scenic rivers, et cetera. Those projects, we like to look at those individually, so more often than not, we do not include those in as acceptable under a nationwide permit. I think I mentioned before, you can, if you look at the water quality certification that happened in 3/30/13 of this year, the nationwide permit has some exceptions. If you look for that on our website, that'll give you the exceptions I was just referring to. Okay, permitting scenarios. If we're dealing with a tenth of an acre and no Cat 3 wetlands, then there's really no notification. And we're talking about now from the Corps standpoint. You don't have to notify the Corps. And if that activity could qualify for both a nationwide permit for 404 and a water quality certification if all of our conditions, both the federal conditions and state conditions, are met. Another scenario is that the activity can qualify for just coverage under the nationwide permit, but there are a few conditions that we have added additionally that they cannot meet. And in that situation, they could get a nationwide permit, a 404 nationwide permit, but they'd also have to get an individual 401 water quality certification. And the third scenario is an activity could require both an individual 404 and a 401. So there's really three scenarios there based on that one-tenth of an acre and no Cat 3 wetlands. So, you know, there's three scenarios. We're here to work with you if you need to ask any questions on when and if it'll be covered under which of those three scenarios. Okay, here's just a list of some of the key state statutes that we have here in the state that we operate under. It's a 611.02 through 029, and that's the isolated wetland law. Again, we were one of the first states. We actually were the first state in the country to have an isolated wetland law, and we were the second state in the United States to have an emergency wetland provision until we could get an actual wetland law. 611.12, that's our anti-degradation rule, and that, you know, kind of dictates how we look at alternatives analysis and whether or not we can allow some degradation to water quality. And then we have the application for water quality certification section, which is 611.3. Some of the key rules that we have, Ohio Administrative Code 3745.1, which is our water quality standards, 3745.1, 50 through 54, that's the wetland anti-deg, or wetland anti-degradation water quality standards. And then we have 3745.32, which is just more of our administrative 401 water quality certification rules. Stream and wetland assessment tools. Wetland definitions. We're going to talk now about, I think most people know what a wetland is, and so I won't read all of this, but the key thing to understand in the wetland definition is that all three components do not have to be present at the exact same time. So in other words, you can have a wetland that has no water in it currently, but it has wetland vegetation and has wetland soils, it's still considered a wetland. It's rare, though, that if it has water and it has hydrophytic vegetation, but it's still possible that it could possibly also not have wetland soil. So we need to have all three of those things present, but they all do not have to be present simultaneously. So when it comes to the presence for indicators of hydrology, if the water is not present, we can look to indicators. And one of the indicators is hydric soil. Another indicator is hydric vegetation, hydrophytic vegetation. And, of course, the third is just proof that there has been hydrology there, stained leaves, stains, or water marks on trees, et cetera. Wetland assessment tools. Ohio was one of the first states in the country to come up with an Ohio rapid assessment method for wetlands. Several other states have copied that, or to some degree has made it their own, changed it to fit their state. But that kind of measures the quality of a wetland. This is for a wetland that is in a natural state, not necessarily a wetland that has been built or created for mitigation purposes. So it measures the quality, and it's kind of a quick method, a cheap method, and most applicants use that methodology to determine the category of wetland. And then, of course, we use that final determination to determine how we, how and if and when we can approve a project. There's a more detailed approach. That's the VIBI, the Vegetative Index of Biotic Integrity, which is more expensive, more time-consuming, but it is more accurate, and some applicants decided to go that route, and it's based on plant species diversity. And like I said, it's more expensive, more time-consuming, but it is a more accurate determination of the quality of the wetland. We also have an amphibie, or the amphibian index of biotic integrity, and in that way you can also categorize the wetland if you so choose, based on the amphibian species that are found. Just to say, the ORAM can be done pretty much all year if there's not a much snow cover. The VIBI can only be done during the growing season, so you're limited there. And the amphibian can only be done during the amphibian breeding season. So there is a high correlation between all three. So we generally, I'd say 99% of the time, get the same score or the same category of wetland, regardless of what assessment tool you use. The IBI, intensive survey of all plant species and communities. It is pretty intensive. It must be conducted, like I said, during the growing season, and so oftentimes the applicants can't fit that into their game plan, and therefore they choose to go with the ORAM. And the same with amphibians. Again, you're looking at a limited window. I didn't put it here, but there's a more limited window as to when you can actually do that type of assessment. And so, again, most applicants choose the ORAM because it's more universal and can be done in a bigger window. Wetland categorization. ORAM score is in the parentheses here if you look below. Category 1, that's our most common, our lowest quality wetland. We wring our hands the least on impacting those wetlands. Well, there's a gray zone in between that and the modified Cat 2. Still within the gray zone, we normally would say that would be a modified Cat 2, or if it's a modified Cat 2 close to the next zone, we would call that a Category 2. So we normally defer up to the next highest category. And these are based on ORAM scoring now. What we can do in a situation like this is, or a person can do, an applicant can go out and do a VIBI, and then there's no gray zones. I mean, it's pretty hard and fast numbers there. But Category 1, gray zone, Category 1, 2, modified Cat 2, Cat 2, all of those first four bullet points are generally very easy to get permits for. You have to do what is needed in the application, give us what's needed, and do the correct mitigation. But for the most part, we usually allow permits to those. A Category 2, which is our most common wetland in the state, that's a medium quality wetland. So we have concerns about those. That's why there's a higher mitigation ratio for those. But for the most part, if there's some avoidance and minimization that's taken place, we're usually pretty good at allowing impacts to those. Category 3, on the other hand, it's very rare that we ever approve a Category 3 impact. They're very high quality. They're rare within the state of Ohio, and locally extremely rare. So when you're looking at a Category 3 impact, a lot of people, when they find that through an ORAM score, they'll immediately go out and do a VIBI to see if they can discredit the ORAM score. But if you come up with a Category 3 in both the VIBI or an amphibie and the ORAM, it's going to be a pretty steep hill to climb to get an approval for that type of project. Here's just some pictures, some examples. This is a typical Category 1 wetland, low quality, kind of a monoculture type situation, not a lot of water standing, although, like I said earlier, it doesn't have to have that. But probably some bases that I can see growing in that. So all in all, it's common, low quality, and pretty easy to mitigate for or recreate. Category 2 wetlands. This is a dry season Category 2 wetland right here, but it's got some forest components. It's got some native species growing. I don't see anything that would tell me that it's got a lot of invasives in it, and so essentially this is our typical wetland in the state of Ohio. And again, following the correct steps and all, usually approval can be obtained for those. Category 3 wetlands, and this is showing something with a lot of water, but if this were dry right now, it would still be a Category 3 wetland. You're looking at a mature forested component. Generally, Category 3 wetlands are larger in size, have no invasive species, maybe have some threatened and endangered species, generally have some other components such as mature forested, tree areas, sometimes even bogs and fens. There are always bogs and fens are Category 3, so sometimes it will have some of those high acidic and high alkaline components as well. Those are all considered Category 3. They're rare in the state and not easily permitted. Let's talk about streams. Stream classification. We have in our rules, we have designations for streams. These are streams that have been designated either by kind of a benchtop review years ago or by virtue of actual site visits. And those designations are in our rules. They're there, so if anyone's looking to request an impact or permit to one of those, you can easily look those up and determine what they're designated for right now, what they're designated as in our state rules. The ones that kind of come to mind that we want to talk about, we have exceptional warm water habitat, and that's less than 10% of our streams, so they're very uncommon. Warm water habitat, kind of our most common, so exceptional warm water habitat's kind of a Cat 3 of streams in a way. Warm water habitat's kind of a Cat 2 type stream from a wetland standpoint. It's pretty common. We have modified warm water habitat, which has some things that are affecting its quality. It could be acid mine drainage, or it could be constantly going through ditch maintenance of some sort. We have a limited resource water that's kind of permanently degraded and can never be turned around. We have cold water habitat streams, which are again kind of a Category 3 from a wetland standpoint type of streams, and they're extremely rare in the state of Ohio. And then we have seasonal style mounted streams as well, which are trout streams. We have very few of those as well. So the cold water habitat, seasonal style mounted, and the EWH, exceptional warm water habitat streams, are the ones that we have the biggest concern about impacts to. Some of the assessment tools that we use for streams, you'll find, especially if you're looking at a lot of the smaller streams in the state, they haven't been designated. There's just so many streams in the state, and we start getting down into the smaller orders of the streams, like the first, second, and third order, or fourth sometimes, and fifth order streams. We haven't been able to get out to actually designate all those. So what an applicant's required to do is to do with a UAA, which is a use attainability analysis. And that essentially, you're kind of doing our workforce in a way. You're going out and doing sampling based on the next three types of assessments. So QHEI, which is kind of the habitat feature of the stream. And then you're looking at fish populations, and you're also looking at macros. And so you would need to go out and do those and propose to us what you feel that particular stream is attaining, i.e. what its use attainability analysis is. Here's just some pictures to kind of show you some of the things that we do and something that you would probably have to do if we hadn't done it on a particular stream that you were seeking a permit for. Fish sampling, here's just some examples, some photographs of the different methods. So you can see a lot of equipment. If you look at the upper left-hand corner there, there's a lot of, boats and electronic equipment needed. Of course, smaller streams, there's wading methods involved. Of course, we use boats a lot of times. And then we do some processing in the field, and sometimes we need to bring it back to the office to do a more in-depth study of what we find. Here's something to kind of give an indication of macros. How to find macroinvertebrate species out in the stream, the Hester-Dendy model that you see up there on the left. Those kind of imitate natural substrate, and so they're required to be kept in a stream for a good period of time, and during that time they'll be colonized by various macros, and then we pull them out and determine what macros are living there. And based on that, we can determine the quality of the stream. Here's some photographs of some of the higher quality streams. On the left, that's kind of what they look like, kind of your typical streams that you'd see kind of in the upper right and what we would consider to be a modified warm water habitat, typical type stream in the lower right. Okay, headwater habitat streams. Now we're looking at less than 1 square mile. So these are your smaller first, second, and third order streams that I talked about earlier. And we kind of look at those streams, kind of categorize those in a way similar to high quality streams, bigger streams, and high quality wetlands. We kind of have a low, medium, and high quality. The low quality is the ephemeral flow, which means that there's very little growing in it. They do process some floodwater situations, nutrients that are a source of organic material for downstream, but they're generally kind of a dead stream, so to speak. And ephemeral means that they only flow during rain events or snow melt events, so there's no groundwater connection and no springs, and so therefore they're dry a lot of the year. The more seasonal flow regime, we're dealing more like an intermittent stream, so they will support some amphibians, will support some aquatic insects, but they're generally connected to groundwater just on a limited basis. So that's why they're intermittent in nature. And then, of course, we have permanent cold water flow regimes. And in those situations, you're generally connected to the groundwater most, if not all, of the year. There's generally springs flowing year-round. They generally support a cooler water type of aquatic environment there. They're much more rare. They're much harder to mitigate for, to recreate. And so those are the streams, and these smaller headwater streams that we have our biggest concern about. A few examples of those. Here's a typical ephemeral stream. You can barely see a defined bed and bank, but there is one there. Here's an intermittent stream, obviously it has a bed and bank. And this stream could potentially be dry or almost entirely dry a lot of the year, but it's still intermittent and has enough water in it, enough of the year to be able to allow for some aquatic organisms to go through their life cycle. And then your typical perennial cold water stream, very high quality. Here the little drop-offs would prevent fish passage, but there's still a lot of high quality macros that would indicate that this is a very clean, cold, high quality stream. So this is something, again, from a small stream standpoint that we would have some concerns about permitting. Just kind of a cautionary note here. This stream would kind of look like maybe an ephemeral to possibly an intermittent if you just looked at it based on its habitat features. But biology trumps habitat, so if we actually, this is a particular stream that we did some sampling on and found some very high quality cold water habitat organisms living in this not so pretty stream. So again, that's why science really trumps our visual impact of the stream. So we can't go out and just say, that's a pretty stream, you know, we need to avoid it, or that's a not so pretty stream, do what you need to do. We need to actually look at the habitat there and make a decision based on science. Okay, now we're going to talk about the 401 certification process and also isolated wetland permitting processes, and this is more of the details that you probably really want to hear about. Of course, 401 isolated wetlands, it covers a gamut. I mean, just about anything that requires fill to be placed in the water of the state or water of the U.S., anything below the ordinary high water mark would require 401. And/or an isolated wetland review. Some of the main steps involved with the 401 certification, we like to see everyone, if possible, coordinate a pre-application meeting with us. It's not required, but it helps you and us to get a handle on the project that you're proposing so that we can kind of steer you and you can steer us in whatever direction needs to be attained to get a permit so that we can speed up the process. It's an extra step, but it actually speeds up the review process. The next thing is to submit a 401 application, and of course this requires a jurisdictional determination from the Corps and a public notice. Without those, we can't consider it by state law and state rule to be a complete application. We have 15 days to determine if something is complete or not. That's 15 business days, which I should have really put there. So 15 business days amounts to almost 3 weeks that we have to determine whether something is complete or not. Once it's complete, then we public notice that complete application, and it's out for comment for 30 days. There's generally a site visit necessary, not always, but generally so, and the site visit can take place before the public notice, during the public notice, or after, but of course we can't make a decision until after the public notice is complete. Sometimes projects either are required to, the public hearing is required, i.e. if it's a proposed impact of Category 3 wetland, but oftentimes we will grant a hearing request from applicants, or not generally not applicants, even applicants, I guess, for that matter. Applicants sometimes request a hearing so that they don't have to wait 30 days to find out that there is a hearing request, and then they have to go back through an additional 45-day hearing period. But oftentimes the request is made to Ohio EPA to hold a hearing from citizens or citizen groups. We don't hold a hearing just because one person or just a few people will request a hearing. Most often the request for the hearing and the issues that they have with a particular project aren't something we can look at anyway, so I'd say the vast majority of requests are not granted for hearings. However, if there's a hearing request from a large group, be it an environmental group or someone, an elected official of some sort, then we generally always will hold a hearing in those situations. Once a hearing is over and if people have submitted comments in the hearing, then we will prepare what's called a response to comments, and then soon thereafter we will take an action on the water quality certification. Of course, after that, whatever conditions are included in the 401 certification, we will follow up on those conditions. So compliance as far as what particular impacts you are permitted to do, we will follow up to see if you in fact have done that, and also the mitigation that's required, we'll follow up on that as well. Some of the major considerations, and I sort of talked about this just a minute ago, we're not either for or against a project. Our decision is based on only water quality impacts. So the popularity of the project, if someone calls in and asks for a hearing or wants us to deny a project just because they don't want it to happen in their backyard, that doesn't affect our decision. We're not land use planning agencies, and we're not zoning agencies, or not a zoning agency, so we don't get involved in that. We don't get involved in labor or non-labor workforce, other than the fact that we do look at and consider the amount of jobs that a particular project would create in an area and the need for jobs in that area. Some other considerations here. We, from an environmental standpoint, our biggest concern is the quality of the streams and the wetlands. So that's where we look at the categorization of the wetlands. That's where we look at the designations of the use attainability analyses of the streams, etc., and we fold those into our review. Of course, we also look at the nature and extent of the proposed impacts. We look at any indirect as well as direct impacts. Has the applicant avoided and minimized? This is a very important thing. That's probably second of importance to the quality of the streams and wetlands. We look at the justification of the proposed impacts, and again, we also take into consideration the jobs factor there. And we look at, finally, if it is an approvable project, we look at whether the proposed mitigation is sufficient, follows our rules, and we feel will be successful. our anti-deg review. Anti-deg degradation kind of allows the director to authorize a lowering of water quality, but he has to look at several factors. He has to look at, one, an alternatives analysis. Two, he has to look at an intergovernmental review of the project, and he has to look at anything that's come out of the public involvement segment. And the director then determines whether the project will not result in a violation of aquatic life use. If he determines that, then he can, in fact, approve the permit. I think I mentioned this earlier, but no impacts to Category 3 wetlands can be authorized unless an applicant demonstrates public need. So in other words, I think I mentioned earlier, we very rarely approve Category 3 wetland impacts because very rarely the public need can be demonstrated. Preferred alternatives, when someone is submitting an application to us for a project, they have to submit three different alternatives to us. One is the preferred alternative, or the preferred design, as we call it, and that is the design or the project that they want to impact, and that has to show some avoidance and minimization in that particular alternative, and that's what that is again what you're asking to be permitted to do. Then there's a minimal deg alternative, which is a somewhat reduced version of the preferred alternative, and people have sometimes submitted several alternatives there. And then there's a non-degradation alternative, which shows how you could do the project if all the water dependent or all the impacts to waters of the state are avoided. And again, there's plenty of space within that non-degradation alternative to say why this will or will not meet the project purpose and need. So oftentimes, you know, an applicant will say that that particular alternative, even though it's doable, would not result in the required needs of the project and therefore would not be something that they would choose. Now, just remember that we can choose any three of these. I think I talk about this a little later, but so you want to be careful how you word these, because we could essentially approve the minimal deg alternative with some components of the non-deg and some of the preferred alternatives. So, you know, there's a lot of variety that we can actually approve there. But the key thing to remember is that this is to kind of stave off people giving us really what they want to do as their minimal deg alternative. Your the fees that are involved, the application fee, of course, is $200, but the review fee is based on the impacts of your preferred alternative. So if you really want to do your minimal deg, make that your preferred alternative, or you're going to pay for that, for you know, not being totally upfront with us. Then, of course, there's a mitigative technique, which a mitigative technique it needs to be involved in all three of the first three alternatives. So you need to have what mitigation is involved with the preferred, with the minimal deg, and with the non-deg alternative. Normally, there's no mitigation. I say normally, but not always. There's usually not any mitigation required for a non-deg alternative. Now, also, just something to point out, we do not require a non-deg alternative for a water-dependent project. In other words, if you're trying to build a boat dock, we can't say, well, okay, give us a non-deg alternative where you build no boat dock. Well, then, therefore, you're not building a boat dock, so that doesn't make any sense. So if you're something like that that's water-dependent, it only can take place and only needs to take place within water, then, you know, that's, you know, if that's the case, if you're not going to be, it's not a water-dependent project, don't worry about the non-deg alternative, okay? So. Alternatives analysis. This is just some examples here of, this was a preferred alternative, or like I said, a preferred design. I don't know how well you can see, but if you look kind of down in the lower left corner of the area that's highlighted there, the area that's outlined, there's some red lines, and those are waters of the state there. So your, so a preferred alternative, if you wanted to do everything, would be to completely impact the entire site. Again, my recommendation would be that your preferred alternative looks something more like the next thing, which would be your minimal dig alternative. And this shows some avoidance, some minimization, and of course the fees for this will be a lot lower, and it makes a whole lot more sense to us. You then will have proven that you've done the avoidance and minimization that's required. So I would make something like this your preferred alternative, and then make a slightly less impacting minimal dig alternative as your minimal dig. And then, of course, you're required to do unless it's a water-dependent project, a non-dig alternative, which shows total avoidance of all the waters on site, including their buffers. And you can see in this particular example how that would severely impact the footprint of the project. But if we're looking at cold water habitats or seasonal sound-mounted streams there and Category 3 wetlands, that may be the outcome anyway. Okay, we have an intergovernmental review requirement, and that's where we coordinate with all the different agencies that have a piece to the puzzle of getting a 401 certification. So that would be the Department of Natural Resources, U.S. and Fish and Wildlife Service, and our Drinking and Groundwater Division here at Ohio EPA. Public participation, sort of talked about that earlier, but we again would be announcing this in the paper. Copies of the public notice would go out to mailing lists of people in the county or region, or people who have requested to be on that mailing list. The public has 30 days to submit comments once that's in the paper, and the public may request a formal hearing during that 30-day period, and that's again why some applicants, from a time standpoint, just request that we go right out with a public hearing right out of the gate. Mitigation. I think I mentioned this earlier. You can only be looking at mitigation. It needs to be part of your package when you submit it to us. However, we kind of look the other way at that until we see whether this is an approvable project or not. So once we know it's an approvable project, then we look at the mitigation and see whether you followed the correct ratios and that sort of thing. And again, if you're dealing with high quality Category 3 wetlands or taking out an entire huge wetland complex, or if you're dealing with high quality streams, some of those impacts are just too severe. Therefore, our anti-dig process would not allow us to allow that much of a lowering of water quality. So in those situations, no amount of mitigation can really justify the project. Here's some different mitigation techniques. That was one of the alternatives that I said really needs to be included in all three of your alternatives analysis. Here's some of the things that people have given us in the past for mitigation, and this kind of follows our preference as well. We prefer right now mitigation banks to be the first preference of mitigation. Second to that, once we have an in-lieu fee mitigation program in effect in the state of Ohio, that would be our second choice. And our third choice then would be on-site mitigation, and this was applicant conducted. And also then the final preference on our part would be that if you're greater than 1 mile away from the site, doing, again, applicant-constructed mitigation. So, banks first, in-lieu fee second, on-site third, off-site fourth. Monitoring, we ask for monitoring for at least 5 years, sometimes 10 years for forested wetlands. This is mitigation monitoring now. And require mitigation wetlands to be of equal or higher quality than the impacted wetlands. So in other words, it's kind of misleading, because if it's a Category 1 wetland, we only accept Category 2 mitigation. If it's a Category 2 wetland, we only then accept mitigation that's as high or higher than the quality of that Category 2. Of course, Category 3 would have to be Category 3 as high as the Category 3 was or higher. So in other words, it could be an extremely high Category 3 for mitigation, even though it was a average high quality Category 3 wetland that was impacted. Banks for in-lieu fee. Right now, like I said, our preference is that you would go to a bank for mitigation first. Banks are, they have a very stringent review process. the Litigation Bank Review Team, or now it's called the IRT. That IRT essentially looks over these wetland mitigation sites, makes sure that they remain high quality, so those particular banks, we have the confidence level that if mitigation is done there, that it's done right. We hope to, in the near future, to have MOC mitigation programs as well. We would have the same, confidence level in those. Right now we do not have any stream mitigation. We have stream mitigation rules, I must say. So essentially, we have a lot of flexibility here. Hopefully soon there'll be banks and MOC programs. If you want to consider on-site restoration or relocation, we can look at that too. Generally, we look at 1.5 to 1 as a mitigation ratio. We give a little less credit than the 1.5 to 1. So let's say you're impacting something and at 1.5 to 1, you want to include 1 to 1 as actually a restoration on site, then we would only give you 0.5 to 1 for the preservation component of it. So, like I said, there's no stream mitigation rules right now. We're in hopes that those will come to pass someday, and that will give everyone some more predictability and give us some more predictability. But in the meantime, it's kind of a case-by-case review with these kind of general, run-of-the-mill type review things. So think about that. Give us a call if you have any questions, and like I said, we'll work with you the best we can case by case on stream mitigation. Possible outcomes from a 401 review. I sort of touched on this earlier, but a project can be approved as is. Any alternative presented can be approved with modifications, and this would be to any alternative presented. The project could be denied, or you can ask that the project be withdrawn. All four of those are viable actions and things that you would like to you should consider when you're applying for permit. Isolated wetlands, this is kind of a different animal, and I'll go into some more detail here. Essentially, with isolated wetlands, we've got three levels of review. We've got a level one review, which now is essentially a general permit. So if you meet all the qualifications, all the conditions and characteristics that we need you to meet that's listed in that general permit, within 30 days you'll either get a letter from us saying you're covered, or if you don't get a letter from us within 30 days, you're covered automatically. Level two, on the other hand, that's a kind of a moderate level review, and in that situation we're looking at lower quality wetlands or smaller impacts to get greater than the level one. And there we have a 90-day statutory requirement to get those permits out the door or take an action. And then we have level three, which is essentially the same as what we do for 401s or full-blown individual 401. That's a 180-day review. And, of course, the key things to remember here is that a Category 3 wetland for an isolated wetland permit is always going to require a level three review. Level one kind of goes through what I just said. There's a pre-activity notice that we require. Still requires a JD from the Corps. The Corps needs to make the decision as to whether these are isolated or jurisdictional wetlands or not. And then, like I said, automatically approved within 30 days. We do send a letter out. We don't keep you guessing. You must submit a level two application. If notified that the project does not qualify for a level one, and of course that's something we would tell you in the letter. In other words, we'd say we're denying your general permit coverage, and therefore you need to submit a level two. An applicant can mitigate at a bank without the objection of the director. So in other words, if you go to a bank anywhere within the core district under this level one review, you're good to go as far as your mitigation. This is only for isolated wetlands. Level two review requires the same thing, a PAN and a JD from the Corps. It also requires an alternatives analysis and an avoidance of high quality wetlands. And the review here can last up to 90 days. Level three is essentially identical, like I said, to the individual 401. The review is 180 days, and this is the one where you're dealing with a large amount of middle to high quality wetlands, and of course any category 3 wetlands would have to go through the level 3 review. Okay, now we're just going to talk about a few things that's happened, has changed already, and then eventually some things that may be changing. Without reading all of this, this talks about, you know, our anti-dig, the swank ruling, which we talked about earlier, budget bills, et cetera, upon us, and the core, the key thing here, I guess, is the 2008 core US EPA wetland mitigation rule, which prompted us to make some changes in our mitigation preference, i.e., we used to prefer on-site mitigation as our first preference. Now it's our last preference. It used to be mitigation banks were our last preference. Now they're our first preference. But now we're, at least we're consistent now with the Corps of Engineers, and we're also, both of our programs with the isolated and the 401 are both consistent as well. We've had ongoing, for as long as I've worked here, stream and wetland rule work groups. We're right now currently not going through any of those, but I'm sure we will in the near future. We've also been in many discussions with the agricultural community regarding ditch maintenance, and we're still wrestling with the issue of cumulative impacts and how to get a better handle on those, and we're also working to seek better integration with the stormwater and TMDLs and the 401 program. And some of the initiatives that we are working on right now, we are in the process and will soon have a new application form for 401s that is very similar to our isolated wetland application, so it'll be a little more straightforward, a lot less wordy, and a little more clear-cut, and a guidance document to help you navigate through that new 401 application when it does come to pass. The dream is to have an electronic application form. We're not quite there yet. The form that we're going to have will be have fillable fields in it, but you will not be able to submit it electronically yet. That's a dream. Also, we're considering doing tiered reviews for 401, similar to the tiered review that I just mentioned for isolated wetland permitting. In other words, we already have the first component, the level one, i.e. the general permit, that's called a nationwide permit, and we're thinking about, we're actually getting ready to implement it in-house to see how it works, so it really won't affect negatively anybody outside the agency, but we're looking at a tier two review, which would be similar to a level two, isolated wetland review, which would have a 90-day turnaround time rather than the 180 that we have now, and then our Tier 3 review would be just the same as it is right now, 180 days. So we're kind of messing with that right now to see if that's going to save applicants time and us time as well. We're always working on and trying to update and justify some of our technical review criteria. So that's an ongoing process, and we're always doing external training, although recently, because of state budget concerns and all, we've not done as much external training as we would like. We still have ORAM trainings twice a year, twice a spring. We used to have them twice a spring and twice a fall, but we've kind of cut back on that. And so our external training is something we like to do and want to do, and when we can afford to do that again and have the time and the budget to do so, we will start doing those more so. And here's a key slide. If you want to expedite your 401 review, and this actually goes for isolated wetland reviews as well, submit a complete application in the proper format the first time around. Most of our time is spent getting applicants to follow the format that we asked for and give us the information that we need to do a review. We spend a tremendous amount of time going around and around and back and forth with applicants on that. As part of that complete application in the proper format, submit complete, accurate stream and wetland assessments and do those during the proper season. We find a lot of people who will do them out of season, and we have to send them a letter back saying you have to redo your assessments because they weren't done in the proper season. So if you do those first two, it's going to get you a long way toward getting these projects approved and out the door quicker. once you've given us this application, of course, we're going to be reading it to see if you've actually submitted a meaningful, implementable alternatives analysis. If you're not being reasonable there, we're going to know that, and we're going to be then back and forth with you on what is a meaningful alternative that we can approve. So once you've done those three, let's just say that it becomes an approvable project, then we'll start looking hard at the mitigation plans. And in that situation, we also want you to follow the format and forms that we have for our mitigation plans and submit those to us so that we can find what we're needing in a hurry and we can, get to the meat of whether this is an appropriate mitigation plan or not. And then another issue is if your project changes, and this happens sometimes, and it can't be helped, but oftentimes an applicant will change a project design and they won't tell us about it. And so we'll go ahead and either approve or disapprove or make changes in a design that has already changed, and therefore we're all wasting a lot of time. Sometimes then you have to come back for a 401 modification, and we have no timeline for those, so we get to those when we get around to them. So, it slows down your project. So give us any change as soon as you know about it. Send us send a change to us in writing if it needs, if warrants, some sort of a plan format change. Send that to us as well, because that'll just slow your project down. And here's kind of a look at our section as it is right now. The section that I manage is kind of composed of three units. The wetland ecology unit, right now there's only one person involved in that unit, and that's a fellow by the name of Brian Guerra. He does primarily grant work associated with US EPA, and it's more of a wetland research type position. Then we have the mitigation compliance unit. Right now we're going through a change, so we have no one in that particular position, but we'll have as many as two, but for sure one soon, and that person or persons will be doing mitigation follow-up and compliance to make sure you impacted what you said you were going to impact and didn't impact what you said you were going to avoid, and also that you did the mitigation that was requested and required. And then following that is the bigger unit within the section, and that's the permitting unit. We have a new supervisor. Her name is Rachel Talby. She's very helpful and can be a very important resource for you. So contact Rachel whenever you need any questions answered. Below that, it shows all the different reviewers and what their responsibilities are. Some of them are divided up into our district offices. Some of them are kind of divided up into types of projects, like coal projects, shale and gas and other projects, and ODOT projects are kind of specific there. Otherwise, they're all broken down into to our district offices. So, contact any of those people if you want, and if you can't get a hold of any of those people, or if Rachel happens to be busy, you can always contact me as well. And there's my contact information. Do you have